And it's my privilege to share my experiences on this topic. Let me first note it before. I hope you can see the screen, all of you.
Yes, please. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So I would like to start this presentation on the use of industrial waste materials in transportation facilities. This is one area that we have been working in the last few years, and we would like to show the things that we have been doing in this particular area of research. Just an introduction before we start the main part of the research work that we have carried in this area. As all of you will be aware that the country is going over a lot of infrastructure development, and in the news, I'm sure all of you would have come across the Bharatmala project, which is a mega project that the government of India has initiated. And you can see the length of the highways, national highways, that is being constructed, 83,000 kilometers, and the amount of money that is being pumped in this project, 7 lakh crore project in expenditure in 5 years time frame. And of course, you will see many other highway projects that are being constructed in the country. And I would like to also touch upon another very important project, a prestigious project for the country that is being constructed, which is abbreviated as MAHSR, Mumbai Ahmedabad High Speed Rail Project. And you can see here, it's a connection from Mumbai to Sabarmati in Gujarat. And the total length is given here. And the most important thing to notice is the travel time to cover this almost 460 kilometers is being planned for 2 hours with all the stops, 2.58 hours is what is being targeted. And this project is again a very prestigious project. And the reason I am pointing out to this project is because a lot of construction is going to happen on earth, be it embankments that is shown here. And of course, this is mainly a viaduct, is a structural facility. If you look at a retaining wall, reinforced retaining wall, back to back, the rail is coming on top of it. You will see that a good portion of this particular project is also being constructed on this reinforced earth structures. Now, looking at these projects, this is already discussed, the Mumbai Ahmedabad High Speed Rail Project and Regional Rapid Transit System, again, another prestigious project. And looking at all these projects, the question is, this will involve huge quantities of material. And the next thing to address is, do we have the competent natural granular fill material near these project sites? Doesn't make sense if we were to go and bring the material from more than 10 kilometers, 15 kilometers, it's not going to be economical solution. So we have to look at the innovative solutions and also for alternative materials to construct these structures. So there are many industrial waste materials. Most of us who are in this particular presentation, I'm sure all of you have used them, the pond ash, slag deposits, scrap tires, C&D waste, and waste foundry sands. So what I'm going to focus on in the next 15 minutes or so is using these materials and how do we go about the design. So I will not go into the details of how these materials are being generated. We all know that coal ash or pond ash is generated from thermal power stations through electrostatic precipitators. And one thing that we need to notice is this amount of material, the pond ash, is humongous production in every year. You can see 192 tons of material is being generated every year, and utilization is not to the full extent. If you look at the utilization chart, the one thing to notice is unutilized fly ash is about 33%. Though the cement industry is using a lot lately, there is still unutilized fly ash material that is present. And this is how it looks like, a ponded ash that is being dumped in a landfill site near to any power station that you will come across. Waste foundry sands, again, these are the waste sand that is generated from metal casting molds. Again, the production is not huge, but when you have a factory that is near to the site location, this will be available for us to use. Steel slags, again, lately there is a lot of production in steel industry because of development in infrastructure or construction activities, which means a lot of slag is being generated, be it copper slag, steel slag, zinc slag, or aluminium slag. And also another waste material that is a serious problem outside India, let's say in the US or in Europe, but not so serious in Indian setting at this point, but down the line, 10 years, 15 years, this should be a serious problem. The waste tires that are being generated every year. If you look at the Indian setting, about this many million waste tires are being generated every year, whereas it's a much serious problem in outside, as I said, in China, US, and others. Now, coming to the main focus of the presentation, which is, can we replace the natural granular material with these waste materials that we have just discussed? Now, the application that we have been focusing in the last 7-8 years is use of these materials in reinforced edge structures. For example, I have a retaining wall that is reinforced. This is a select backfill material, as all of us know. Can we use these waste materials as a replacement to the natural material is the number one question. And the second thing is, can we use this material also for any reinforced slope retaining slope structure or a steep slope? So with this application in mind, we are looking at how do we go about getting the properties. Before that, I would like to emphasize that the different components in any RE wall construction, the fill material amounts to almost 35 to 40% of the total project cost. So finding a suitable fill material near to the site location is very, very important. When you, of course, facing panels, geogrids, they make up the rest of the cost. So if you look at this application in particular, this is the reinforced fill that we are talking about. The designer would like to get if I assume it as a slip mechanism, while you are designing the structure, the main design parameter that one would look for is this interaction. There is a sliding of this whatever fill material we are proposing, here in this case the industrial waste material, with this on top of this geogrid. So that is an interface shear test property. Whereas here, if you look at element two, if I look at zoom it and look at it, this is how it looks like. The reinforcement is being pulled in the oblique direction. So one has to look at the axial pullout and the transverse pullout testing. So what we will be focusing in this presentation or the results is, I would like to give an overview of the results with respect to this interface shear testing and with respect to this axial pullout testing. Though we have results for transverse pullout testing, I am not going to present in this particular talk. Now, the designer will look for, as I said, this parameter, which is RI, which is the efficiency of the geogrid with respect to shearing, which is nothing but in the numerator, we have interface shear strength, and in the denominator, we have the soil to soil, the fill to fill shear strength. So that ratio is what we need while we are designing it. This is pertinent to this particular location, element one. Whereas the pullout, as we all know, the pullout is calculated using this expression, the normal stress at that level, we multiply with a pullout resistance factor. This factor is very important because how the material is behaving in pullout under a given normal stress is required while we are designing the reinforced edge structure. So once we are proposing the industrial waste materials to be used for such applications, can we obtain these parameters through experimentation? So is what we have been looking at, as I said, in the last few years. And I would like to show some results. I don't think I will go in detail, but just a overview of the results. Now, looking at pond ash, we have used different pond ash materials from different locations in the country. And it, of course, satisfies the gradation for a fill material. And the classification, and if you look at the density, again, as we all know, fly ash is a very lightweight material, so it's very conducive material for retaining structures because the lateral stresses will be much reduced in this case. Now, if you look at different fly ashes in the country, you of course can do the comparison. And the morphology, again, you can look at it as a sub-rounded to granular. You can see some sub-rounded particles here, whereas some granular particles here. So this is a very useful material in terms of the interaction properties. Chemical composition, again, the Indian fly ashes, you will see alumina, silica, and iron oxide will combine together, will be almost more than 70%. Now, this is the class F fly ash. And of course, the roughness is also important because the interaction of the reinforcement with the pond ash material, the roughness of the reinforcement is going to dictate the property. So we have studied the roughness properties of different geograde materials. You can see here, UXG1, UXG2, G3, and G4. These are the different types of geograde materials that we have tested. And I would like to show some results from interface testing. I don't get into the details of how the sample was prepared in a direct shear box, compaction done. And this is at the interface. You place this geograde that we are proposing to use with this particular material and then do the shear testing. So one thing that I would like to emphasize is this is the shear strength envelope for only pond ash material. Once you have pond ash with respect to different geogrades that we have used, this is the shear strength envelope. So this ratio at a given normal stress is what we are talking about, RA factor. So now if you look at different values, you can see that the range is somewhere average, I can say, is about 0.7 or 0.8 for different geogrades that we have tested. So the interface shear strength is about 75 to 80% of the shear strength with respect to the pond ash material. So now coming to the axial pullout testing, again, this is the axial pullout test facility that we have at IIT Hyderabad. This is a test box for pullout testing. This is the axial pullout setup where we can clamp it and then pull it in the horizontal direction. And this is all filled with the material that we are going to use, the industrial waste material that we are proposing here. This is for the application of normal stress. We also have the transverse pullout test facility in the same box, but I'm not going to discuss that in detail here. Now, a top view of the clamping system, the load cell, and the actuator or the hydraulic system to pull the geograde that's going to be embedded in the industrial waste material is shown here. Some more details I'm not going to discuss in detail. So this is the pond ash being prepared, geograde placed, and as a designer, this is what we will be interested in. What will be the axial pullout resistance for different normal stresses for a given geograde and the pond ash material? The one thing to note is, of course, we all know that the mechanism is going to be, because it's a grid, we will have the passive resistance across these transverse strips and also the frictional resistance all along the grid. This will be the resistances that will contribute to the pullout resistance. And one thing to note is for different grids, if you look at the pullout behavior, the actual pullout versus the front end displacement, this is the one that I would like to emphasize on, which is the pullout resistance factor with respect to the normal stress or the overburden depth you can think of. You can see here, the shaded portion is what is the range for the pond ash with respect to different geogrades that we have tested. And then if you compare it with the conventional fill material, like a granular material, sandy deposit, and so on, you can see that if you look at the upper limit, for example, the upper limit for the granular material, the conventional fill material that we regularly use, is not very different. So what we are trying to emphasize is the pond ash material interaction with pond the geograde is not going to be very much different from that of conventional fill material. So with respect to design, there should not be a big difference in terms of using these materials. And this quantification is very important because right now, as I understand, the factor that is being used is highly conservative because we don't have such a guideline to use this material in IRC or MORTH, the Ministry of Road Transport Highway official, the transport highway guideline that is used in the Indian setting. We don't have such the guideline to use this factors, it's very important to quantify them so that we can do a realistic design of these structures using these materials. And of course, these materials are already used in some places. However, as I said, the values of design parameters that are used is highly conservative. So such a study that I have showed you is going to be very useful to use realistic parameters and come up with savings in the design and execution of these structures using this industrial waste material. Some photographs of pond ash being used as a reinforced earth backfill material. You can see at a different location at corners how it is used, the pond ash material being dumped and compacted. So this is the RE wall that is going to join to the bridge structure that we have been discussing. Okay, so how you do the execution near this site. And of course, because we are getting the experimental testing for getting the design parameters, it becomes very imperative to also do a field pullout test and compare the experimental results with the field pullout test results. And then finally, it's very important to put up in a report form so that the agencies can use it on a regular basis with more confidence and the appropriate design parameters. So that was the intent of the study that we have done in the last few years. And this is some photographs of the field pullout testing. Likewise, we have studied on different other materials, waste foundry sand. I won't get into the details, but just show the results that we have obtained. So if you look at the interaction properties, RI, that I have been discussing, again, you can see that it's very similar to the granular film material, not very much different that we may anticipate. Again, for slag material, if you look at the range, again, a very similar range that you can see. Now, another thing that is also possible is a combination of these materials. For example, fly ash can be mixed with granulated rubber, the waste tire that is shredded into pieces. Why not mix them and use it? Possibly the properties are improved and this composite material can be a better option compared to when used alone, be it fly ash or granulated rubbers alone. So this exercise we have done by mixing. And then one thing that is very important in such an application is we have two materials here, a binary packing, essentially of fly ash and granulated rubber. It's very important to use the appropriate mix proportion so that we get the best properties at site. So this is something that we have done. This plot shows the percentage of granulated rubber by weight with respect to void ratio. We can see that the minimum void ratio is achieved at this particular mix ratio, which is what is called the optimum mix. You can see 35 to 50% of total weight of granulated rubber is present. We get an optimum mix proportion. Likewise, we did interaction studies as well on these materials, fly ash and granulated rubber mixtures. And what I would like to mention is these are definitely good options that we have to use them as RE wall backfill or for reinforced steep slope fill material. Again, this is something that is again useful material, which is soil plus shredded tires. Instead of fly ash, we can as well use the soil material and then the shredded tires. You can see here one project in which I was involved, the mixed soil and tire sheds are placed in the site. They are then leveled off or spread out and then compaction happens. So what I want to emphasize is this particular construction is very similar to what you will see for any conventional fill material. So I would like to show very quickly a couple of videos before I close this presentation. So one question is, how do we ensure that the mixing is happening at site? For example, this video demonstrates tires being placed, the shredded tires, and then you have the sand going to be placed, and then you can very easily mix it at site. You can see traditional equipment, the bucket excavator is able to mix it very thoroughly and homogeneously. So it's not a big ask as such. So you can easily mix it in the proportion that you want. And then finally, what I would like to show is the compaction process is as similar to what you will see for any granular fill material. So it's a regular compaction process. Once you have the mixture of tire shed and sand that is being placed in site and then good for rolling. So finally, I think I'm almost there with respect to time. So I would like to conclude this talk with this particular side, saying that industrial waste materials are definitely a possible candidate, especially in this present times, because we don't have the natural fill material readily available, and we are not allowed to mine the natural materials. So it's very important that we identify them, use them appropriately, do proper testing in the lab before we take it to the site. So characterization of relevant engineering properties is important. And then finally, what I would also like to mention is the environmental studies is also very important on this waste materials, because leaching of heavy metals into the groundwater is something we should be very, very much looking after, because we cannot pollute any existing groundwater resource. So with this, I would like to end my presentation. I think 20 minutes is up. So thank you for your patient listening. I would be happy to take any questions from you.
Thank you, Dr. Umashankar, for a very enlightening talk on sustainability aspects of the projects here, like infrastructure projects, be it a retaining structure or a pavement. And you have rightly pointed that environmental studies are very, very important at the end of the day. And the point that I see is how these things are like implemented, because the technical know-how is not very great in India. So that's where we have to work on. I see there are no questions as of now posted in the chat box. So if there are any questions from the panel that are sitting here, yeah, please go ahead and then unmute yourself and ask.
Sir, I have only one basic question, sir.
Please.
Sir, you have used granulated rubber as a waste material here in the project. What is the size of the rubber that you have chosen, sir?
Again, the granulated rubber can be varied size that one can use. Again, that is going to be based on application that we have. The fill material, I have seen myself or been involved with projects where it can be as large as 100 mm also, which is like a large tire shred particle when you're mixing with sand and then using it. So we have to keep in mind that the more the shredding, if you want a very small size of shred, you have to do a lot of shredding process, which is not economical. So keeping that in view, based on the applications that we have looked at for fill applications, they can be as small as 10 mm to as large as 100 mm, 150 mm. Because one other thing that we should keep in mind with this is, because if they are very big size of tire sheds, we cannot do the compaction properly and homogeneous mix cannot be obtained. So that is something that we should keep in mind. So to answer your question in short, the shredded tires with soil can be as large as 100 mm or even 150 mm. It can be as small as 10 mm. So that is for a fill application. So I'm reserving my answer for that fill application. For other type of applications you use for granular media and landfill, so that's a different discussion altogether. The size will be different there.
Yeah. Okay, right. Sir. Thank you, sir.
We have one question from audience like Ashish Malik. So he's asking like, what is the impact, environmental impact of mixing rubber with pond ash in landfills or something?
Okay. I suppose the question is to do with the leaching, what happens to the groundwater level table if we use this particular mixture as a fill material. Okay, so the studies say that pond ash is very safe to use, and we have been using pond ash for the last 20-30 years because the leaching studies on pond ash, extensive studies have been done and no such problem is reported. Tire sheds again, is not a problem because it's again an inert material. So I don't see any problem with respect to any environmental effect on using the mixture of pond ash and tire sheds for fill applications.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. So very nice. There are no further questions. Professor Sridhar, do you have any question? Yeah, please.
One question. Yeah. Sir, what test do you suggest post-construction of these waste material constructions?
Post-construction, I mean, what I would suggest is
we should... The performance.
Okay. To study the performance, madam, what we can always do is, like if it is like a RE structure or a steep slope, we can use the conventional performance monitoring studies like slope indicators and so on to see if there is a slope moment and so on. So, I mean, the same test that we use for any granular fill application. So if you want to monitor the settlements, use settlement gauges. If it is a pavement structure, you measure the edge pressures at different, at subgrade level. So we will go with the same set of monitoring system that we will use for any conventional fill material when we use these materials. Based on application.
Yeah. Yeah. We have one last question. What is the long-term behavior of pond ash as a backfill?
Long-term effect of pond ash as a backfill, as I again said in as an response to the other question, pond ash is a very inert material as such. So long-term behavior should not be a problem because it's categorized as silty sand or in some cases poorly graded sand. So one thing that I would like to mention is one has to be very careful when water is going to come in contact with this pond ash. So you should always ensure that the drainage is proper because, as you know, the pond ash is going to be a problem in terms of load carrying capacity or loss of stiffness once it's going to be inundated. So as long as you don't allow water to seep through it or properly dissipate the pore pressures, you're all fine. So there should not be any long-term issues as such.
Perfect. Yeah. So the constructability and drainage issues are always a challenge. And even if it is a regular material, drainage is a main issue.
Exactly.
I mean, when you're talking about backfill. Perfect then. Yeah. So so on behalf of IGC 2021 and on my personal behalf and the entire committee, definitely I take this opportunity to thank you for joining us today, Dr. Umashankar. And thank you very much.
Thank you a lot.
Yeah.